A few weeks ago, the latest census results were released by the Australian Bureau of Statistics. Now, you might recall that we did record a podcast episode on it. And while there were a lot of interesting findings, one big generational shift has occurred in the last 5 years. So in today's episode, we're going to hone in on this topic and talk about this shift. And joining me to do just that is social researcher and our Director of Solutions, Geoff Brailey. Geoff, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Yeah, stoked to be here and great to be talking about the census again. It's a good topic to hone in on. I like the word. It's a good topic. So let's jump right in.
It's a huge topic. There's lots we could discuss, but we are focusing in today on one. And just before we get into that, Geoff, I was actually away the week the census results were released, but I knew that it would be a big week for the team. We had an event. We had to turn everything around. You were here in the thick of it. You were presenting the results in a presentation at a virtual event that we put on. Can you paint a picture for me and our listeners in terms of what that week looked like?
Yeah, it was a lot of fun, and we certainly loved the cake moment, but more than just having cake, it was a bit of a flurry of activity. Of we kind of were whiteboarding what are the different areas we want to delve into quickly to find what are those key stories nationally by some of the states and cities. And we had our analysts, our demographers, kind of they sort of had some directions of key things to go and look for straight away. Then it was kind of going from the data collection to some analysis and storytelling, which was really saying, cool, here's the data, but what does it mean? And then we kind of produced from that some of the key insights that we took to our design team, who then created beautiful slides and the Australia Street infographic as well. So all within about sort of 36 hours, we were recording the event. It was all pretty fast paced, and yeah, I was stoked to see. Yeah, I think there was over 300 people attended that virtual event and got that snapshot, 1 hour, all the census event. It's still there as an event. People can check it out. But it certainly, just revealed heaps of interesting stats. So it was kind of like, man, outside of work as well, you just want to keep looking and finding the trends. So, yeah, we did a lot outside of work hours in those times. But it's kind of that Christmas period for us where it's the big flurry of activity and a real privilege to be a part of it this year.
Yeah, it's only a once in a 5 year snapshot, and we wanted to get that turned around very quickly. And I imagine there was a lot of media commentary as well from the team, as well as kind of trying to get the data analysed and some late nights there for you guys. So
yeah, that's right. It's the phone just doesn't stop ringing in that week. And yeah, usually we do a few media commentary pieces every day. And yeah, that was just a day. I think Mark must have done 15 or 20 different things that day, a couple of TV, a couple of print. So it was nonstop.
Yeah, I'm like partly sad that I missed it. And then also I'm like, oh, like I remember seeing the WhatsApp group message and I was away and I was like, oh, there's such a fun buzz. We're all working on it to try and get it turned around really quickly. We value our work-life balance here, but some weeks, you know, you're just required to work a bit later. But then I'm like, yeah, happy for the team to have done all the hard work and I get to came back and present on it. And you've done all the amazing analysis and the slides look fantastic. And you've presented it at a few keynotes as well lately. So props to you and props to the team for that quick turnaround.
Yeah, it's lots of fun. It's certainly, yeah, I think it is one of those, everyone who does paid work, meaningful work, even voluntary work, you know that you get out what you put in, and those big effort moments, you really do get the reward from it. So, and it is a privilege to go and present trends from the census. Done a few sessions. It was my positive month in July. I did a session with a positive real estate, positive media, a couple of client shout outs there. It was a really positive month being able to analyze the census data and share it with so many different events and organizers, and yeah, using it in our projects. It's a real privilege.
Yeah, and we will use that ongoingly for months and years to come in our keynote presentations for our clients. It's a key data set. But we are, as I said, honing in on one particular topic today, one of our favourite topics to talk about, which is the generations. So, Geoff, can you tell us what this big generational shift is that has occurred from the last census to the most recent one that came out a few weeks ago?
Yeah, Australia's population has been growing, but there's been a big changing of the guard that's occurred. And Australia's largest generation in the 2016 census revealed that the baby boomers were the largest generation. But in this 2021 data collection by the ABS, it revealed that now the millennials, the Gen Ys, those aged 28 to 42, are the largest generation in Australia. They've risen from 5 million to 5.3 and have overtaken the baby boomers that are at 5.1 million people. So out of 25.4 million people, you kind of can picture this as one in five that's a baby boomer, and just over one in five that is a Gen Y, or the millennials we love to call them. It's certainly interesting to see that changing of the guard, and it's a bit of an iconic moment. It's a baton passing moment where the race of those baby boomers in their working years, they're now entering those retirement years, whereas the Gen Ys, they're certainly in their working years, and that's where that population growth has come, because we're still gaining population over that last five-year period, particularly in those first couple of years pre-COVID. That's where we were gaining through overseas migration, skilled family and humanitarian visas that were granted to people to come and seek refuge or build and be part of the great community of the Australian workforce and Australian society.
Yeah, it's. I find it interesting, actually, that, I mean, the baby boomers, they've got that descriptive label and they get talked about a lot, as do the millennials with another descriptive label. But poor Gen X, like we talk about the forgotten generation, or, you know, and like it's even reflected in the population a little bit. Like, it's not just been passed down to the Gen Xers. But it's just skip them. Now, obviously, we've got a really large proportion of Gen Xers and they're a really important generation to be engaging with. But even just who the media love to talk about, we do find it is the baby boomers and the millennials. It's interesting that that's been reflected in these most recent data.
Yeah, the Gen Xers, they're so close. I mean, they're at 4.8 million people. Mm. So they're half a million shy of their younger generation, the Gen Ys. So still almost 5 million. They're at 19% of the population now, whereas the Gen Ys are at 21%. So it's quite a fascinating little observation, as you say, that maybe that Gen X group, maybe they just get overlooked a little bit and they're playing a key role in society. But the largest group, the new record, it's showing
it's Gen millennials.
Gold medals.
Yeah. And it's interesting as well, because the baby boomers were sort of the last generation to span that 20 years. So it makes sense that they've been the largest, but now we've got that shift in both the Gen X and the Gen Y, or the millennials, and the Gen Zs and the Gen Alphas to come, in our definition, span 15 years each. So it makes it for more of a fair comparison. But I guess we're talking about millennials born at the beginning of the 1980s, and you and the team did some fantastic analysis. I watched the recording back when I got back from my trip, and it was just such an interesting, well-done presentation of the insights. And one of the ones that was really great was kind of comparing how the world looked, or what life looked like, at the beginning of the 1980s compared to today. So using this sort of generational changing of the guard, like you mentioned, that's taken place, as a way to compare life when the millennials began being born to today. So there was lots of different categories we looked at. What were some of those differences that was interesting, you know, that stood out to you, Geoff, what life looks like 40 years ago, four decades ago, compared to today?
Yeah, it's a totally different country. Australia was population size in 1981 at 14.5 million. In 2021, it was 25.4 million. So you do the maths, it's 10 million more people. It's an enormous growth. Even the Australian Torres Strait Islander populations back in 1981 was just at 160,000 people in the, and that's only after finally being recognised as and recorded in the census for a couple of censuses at that point, whereas now it's at over 800,000 people in the 2021, or approaching a million people. So there's a pretty significant social shift there, the times we live in over those four decades. Even the cultural diversity is enormous. We've more than doubled the number of people who were born overseas. Back in 1981, it was 3 million people born overseas. Today, it's over 7 million people born overseas. So again, that cultural diversity, that social change, even through to things like the wages, that we've really seen some, what might sound like some strong growth over four decades. The annual average wage back in 1981 was just less than $10,000 per year, whereas today it's over $90,000 per year. And if you think about how you spend your money, most of it often going on the cost of housing, and the rents back in 1981 were less than $60 per week. My goodness, sounds so affordable. But as part of that, less than $10,000 to live on, it's not so straightforward. But the rent now is over $375 per week in 2021. But the biggest change, I think, would be the house price. And it's certainly a topic that we find so fascinating. Sydney, the price, median house price back in 1981 was $78,000. Today, in the 2021, it's $1.4 million, whereas Melbourne back in 1981 was $44,000. In 2021, it was $992,000, so almost a million. So certainly some real big comparison. And even Brisbane was back then more expensive than Melbourne in 1981 at $45,000, and today just approaching $900,000 at $885,000. So real big change from the cultural diversity, that social narrative around First Nations people, through to just the raw mass of an additional 10 million people. And certainly, I think as we look at the cost of living, the household narrative and the earnings, it's certainly been an interesting period.
Yeah. Mark puts some of these thoughts down in an article for The Age. He authored this article and he wrote in it, the millennials are a generation that parallels a changing nation, and all those stats you've shared there in terms of population, Indigenous and Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander population, earnings, income, house prices, it's just changed markedly over the last four decades. In this article, Mark also sort of painted this picture, which is funny. He said, Dolly Parton's 9 to 5 was playing on the radio or perhaps on cassette tape on the cool new Walkmans that had just been released. Malcolm Fraser was Prime Minister, and of course Queen Elizabeth II was on the throne. And I mean, we love to talk about stats and data, but we also love to humanise it and personalise it. And you were just telling me the other day, Geoff, that one way you sort of do this as a keynote speaker in your sessions is to ask people to reflect on what maybe a Saturday morning looked like for them growing up and the factors that influence a generation. And we've put some of these things down in an infographic where you say the what was the transformative technology, what was playing on the radio, was it Dolly Parton, today it's Harry Styles. You know, it's interesting to think about the changes there. I mean, what did life look like for you, Geoff, growing up in terms of the music that you listened to, the TV you watched, you know, what even safety, like how far did your parents let you roam? Because we're both millennials, so we can add our personal story to this data as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a fascinating one, and I love asking people to think about what it was like to be 10 years old. Were they living in an apartment or a house? Did they get pocket money? Could they watch TV on the weekend? Did they have chores to do? Were they playing sport? And it's often fascinating hearing people say, pocket money, what? It's always the baby boomers and the builders saying, what, you got pocket money? I never got pocket money. And yet it's a baby boomer that was out roaming the streets until it was dark, whereas my generation, I got pretty good permission to go and roam for a couple of hours, but kind of had to be back every so often just to check in. And I could ride the bike down to local shops and spend my pocket money. I was fortunate to get pocket money, and yeah, loved going down buying an ice cream at the local shop and riding down there and hanging out and having a look at surfing magazines or whatever it might have been, and really just loved the, I guess, freedom as a kid. It was a lot of fun playing sports on Saturday morning, whereas even today, if you're a parent, you know that sport isn't just on Saturday mornings. It can be Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday arvo, Sunday. It's a different era as a parent these days. But yeah, asking people about their childhood experiences, for me it was just such a safe time. And I'm very fortunate the home I grew up in, but also the I guess I'd been settled as a sort of Anglo child in the east, sort of in Ryde in Sydney, so very fortunate to grow up in a really safe area. So we were able to go out and ride bikes with neighbours and play with the different kind of cultural groups in the street, and really had a lot of fun as a kid. It was a real privileged time.
Yeah, I think about mine as well, and it's quite similar. I mean, I grew up in suburbia, sort of out in the northwest of Sydney, and grew up in a cul-de-sac, so was spending a lot of time with, and it was a newish suburb at the time. My parents sort of bought and moved into that, and so that was reflected as well in our neighbours, and I spent a lot of time riding bikes and playing in the street, is what we called it, played in the street, with our neighbours who were all sort of growing up together, going to school together. And I just remember, even, again, you hear about things that sound foreign to even us. Like my mum used to say, oh, when I was growing up, the cars didn't even need to have seatbelts. And I'm like, what do you mean you didn't have to wear seatbelts? Like, that's wild. How unsafe. How could that ever be allowed? And so it's just fascinating. But even, you know, you're a parent, Geoff. And so, again, that's another interesting distinguishing, I guess, factor about the millennials, is that they're not the next young generation, they're the parents parenting the next young generation coming through. I mean, you must see some pretty interesting differences to maybe how you are parented versus how you're choosing to parent your kids today as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And even my Saturday mornings, we'd wake up and watch a bit of Saturday morning cartoons, and then you'd get on with your day. And I think about my kids now, we're a household, we've got a couple of streaming services. I think we've got three at the moment, and I think the average household in Australia has about 2.3 streaming services. And so you think about the access to entertainment in this day and age, and as a parent, and I think my kids must be loving it. They've just got all these different shows at their fingertips at certain like any time of the day, they can watch their favorite movie. They don't have to rewind the VHS like I used to have to do, or time the exact moment of watching that favorite show on a TV channel. You can stream for my kids. They can watch Bluey any time of the day, and hence why that show's got the world's for the ABC. It's their largest show ever, because it's this access to content that kids love. It means that you could be waiting in a queue at a health appointment, and all of a sudden you can hear that familiar opening song, and you're just thinking, yep, that parent's watching Bluey, and that's awesome, go on and peek over their shoulder. It's such a fun way to use technology. And I think we've seen, I think for the Gen Y parents, there's been over 3 million Gen Alphas born in Australia. So we've got a young population. The Gen Ys certainly are not just out sipping lattes. And I think they've really started to move into those family-forming years. And that's even into their 40s now for the Gen Ys. So they're not just out having late-night drinks anymore. They're kind of the backbone of society. And that's where it's fascinating. They're now the largest generation. I think they're into those kind of key working years. There, even one of the key stats in the census that surprised me was that half of our defence personnel are Gen Ys, and so 48% of our defence force are Gen Ys. So we've got this young, servant-oriented kind of nation-building generation, and I think that's true for people who've been born in Australia, but particularly for people who've moved to Australia as migrants. They've come here with a great attitude to kind of prosper their own household, but come to help grow a nation as well. And so certainly I think a key part of raising the next generation is passing on that value of being a builder. While we might not have the label of builders like the predecessor baby boomers' parents' generation, I think the Gen Ys would be wise to learn a few things from that generation and try and pass that on to the Gen Alphas as they become the world's largest generation, as you eloquently put in the Gen Alpha book. They're going to be the world's biggest generation living to the 2100s. So great to see what we can shape in that generation.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I was just reflecting even on your answer there around some of the things we wrote in the Generation Alpha book. And I mean, even there's obviously lots of benefits for Generation Alpha and for millennial parents around access to information and you know, some of the things that parents were telling us, presumably millennial parents were saying, you know, parenting kids today, they were like, when we were young, we had to go to the library and find a piece of information and spend lots of time looking through to find it. Today they're like, oh, we just Google it or find it instantly, and we get more time as a family because our kids are kind of spending less time manually trying to find information for homework or assignments. But then you've got, so that's a great benefit of how the world has progressed, but there's also challenges there even. I mean, I think about my upbringing, and I think I was only in year 10 or year 11 when social media really took off, and I'm on the younger end of the millennial sort of generation. So I only really had to grapple with some of that stuff when I was at university, wasn't in those teenage years, you know? So I think that's a difference, but I mean, we've seen a lot of change there, and I've seen some memes even say, like, kids today will never know, and you'll get this, Geoff, I know, because you're a millennial, like, they'll never know the rush of going to Video Easy on a Friday night in your UGG boots and wondering if the video you want to rent is in stock, because, you know, nothing was at our fingertips like it is for your kids today. It's just worlds apart, right?
Absolutely. And even the power of YouTube, a young generation that literally just consuming hours and hours of content. And that's not just the young kids, but those particularly into their teenage years. I think for, as a parent, it's so fascinating seeing the way they learn, the way they want to relax. And to be honest, as a parent, the way I want to relax, I'll be pretty open here. I love watching YouTube and getting sport updates or seeing the latest kind of funny shows. It's a fun way to relax. So I won't be surprised if my kids, kind of what walks in me runs in them. That's what you kind of, I think as a parent, you've really got to be mindful of that. So I think we shouldn't be blaming them for being screen addicted when as adults and parents, we're pretty focused on our phones. And
totally.
I've been challenged lately on the number of times in a day I pick up my phone and check and how many notifications. And it's something I'm monitoring because I'm aware I've got my eldest is 8 at the moment, and she's asking, when can I get my first phone? And
yeah,
And I'm sort of thinking, well, I didn't get one until I left high school. So that was me as I'm now 38 and I got one 20 years ago. Mm. But I don't think she will wait till she's 18. I think it'll be before then. I would love to wait. So we'll see what happens over
how long you can delay and push that back. Oh, totally. And I mean, you mentioned it there as well. I think some of the cool things that have come out and we like to share in our presentations even is kind of challenging people's stereotypes of this generation or of all generations, but of the millennials. And I mean, even the term millennial, it's been a bit of a controversial label in some ways. Like, there's got a few connotations that go along with that. You mentioned, yeah, sort of, you know, house prices, and I feel like anytime you talk about millennials, people probably in Australia anyway think smash davo, house prices, locked out. But I mean, it's also fascinating even for us to think about sort of that generational wealth and income. And yeah, I mean, I know that you love to talk about that, Geoff, and we were just sharing even before around some of those interesting figures and stats around sort of this generation are sort of a sizable one, as we've seen from this most recent census. But they're bigger than the boomers, but they don't have the same sort of asset accumulation, but they've got a higher income, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, this is fascinating. And for the, I guess if you're listening to this, this is probably one of the biggest insights, I think, around people and just prosperity in our nation, that for the older generation who've had over three decades of living, earning, saving without having a recession, they've been very fortunate. In the baby boomer generation, there's a decade, the 65 to 74 year olds, that on average their wealth, their asset base is actually almost $1.7 million. And that's for a household with that 65 to 74 year age group, which is more than double what it is for the younger 35 to 44 year age group that are approaching $700,000 for that asset base. And certainly time is that eighth wonder of the world, the compounding interest. But the biggest thing is that while the boomers, those 65 to 74 year olds, are earning $75,000 a year on average as a household, that younger sort of 35 to 44 year old are actually earning more than double that now. They're earning almost $150,000 household income on average per year. And that's, I think, where that millennial Gen Y age group, you might sort of roll your eyes and think, oh, the snowflake generation, they stop spending money on your coffees and you'll be able to afford a house. They're earning some massive money, but it's just not stacking up when it comes to the housing affordability challenge. But what are they spending that money on? It's where things like education is a crucial thing. And so finding those great schools for kids is a priority for that generation. It's things like the streaming and the technology that we have had kind of infused into our life. We didn't start as screenagers. We didn't start with phones in our hands, but we've adopted as a generation, as Gen Ys, we've integrated technology into our life. And now we're almost entirely dependent and reliable on it, to the point where we now have to consider and find that simplicity as a service and do digital detoxes to find ways to almost check out of the matrix and just find reality once again. But we've got the cash to be able to do that. We've got the support of really strong income, because we're not just in those early kind of earning years anymore. We're not in our young 20s. We're into our late 20s, 30s, and even our 40s as a generation. And so I think what we can expect going forwards is, as Gen Y particularly move into the next decade of their life, and sadly as baby boomers and older builders sadly pass on, we're going to see this great transfer of wealth that might go to some of those Gen X's, the hidden generation there. Some might even trickle down to those Gen Y's and really build on what their asset base is and really propel them into the future. And I even think some people are taking matters into their own hands financially and shifting out of cap cities to propel them into their future financially by moving to a region where they can take some of that cap city income and the cap city equity that's been building and transplant themselves into a region and almost leapfrog ahead, say 10 or 20 years of what that property journey might have been like. So they're certainly an aspirational generation, Gen Y, and they want to start where their parents have finished off. I love that statement that was in the Gen Alpha book, that the Gen Ys have certainly kind of grown up in that baby boomer household that was prosperous and was sort of quite frugal probably to begin with, but has been growing over time. And now they're trying to launch their own families. But that pressure is so different in this age of uncertainty. We've just gone through a recession, now in a period of high inflation, pretty uncertain times. The birth rate's declining because of such uncertainty. it's a real challenge, I think, for the Gen Ys who are trying to figure out how to plan for the future when we just don't even know what's going to happen in the next 6 weeks, 12 months. We've stopped using calendars. We probably need to rebuild that socialising muscle. But yeah, there's so many different factors, I think, impacting the way Gen Y approach life, so different to the way baby boomers raised kids over their previous couple of decades.
Yeah, so many good insights there, Geoff. And yeah, I think the other side of it is that this generation, you know, it's our generation. We're both part of the millennials / the Gen Ys, same label, same but different in terms of, you know, we're also trying to create wealth, not just for ourselves, but for our kids and for our future and for our families. And yet it makes sense. And I know so many people who are millennials who have literally made the move to the regions because the affordability challenge, you know, here in Sydney where we're based or whatever capital city people are from, like you said, trying to propel and move forward. And we haven't seen, we've just seen that disparity between wages and house prices. And now you've got, yeah, rising inflation and interest rates coming into the mix as well. So it's definitely complex. And I think for organizations and for leaders and businesses, it is about acknowledging this generational sort of shift and all the insights that you've shared today. And I thought I'd just read something from an article that Mark wrote because, you know, we are a part of this generation, so we can't really be as objective, but Mark can. He's a Gen X, and he wrote in this article, he said, "So far from being a smash dabbo loving, fast fashion spending snowflake generation, it turns out that the millennials are contributors, influencers and leaders. Long since moving from an emerging generation, they're now the dominant one, yet leading with flatter structures and a global lens. While they've adapted well to the changes that the recent decades have presented, they will no doubt impact the trends that are ahead, and with that, adeptly shape the future." So yeah, it's important, I think, for organizations to just be aware of this this shift taking place and to maybe challenge some of the stereotypes that exist around us millennials.
Yeah, I think it's a good thing to recognize the different strengths of each generation. And that's one of the I think key parts of what we love doing at McCrindle is we love each generation, but yeah, each one's different. And certainly what baby boomers have brought to the table in building our nation's been fantastic. But also I think what Gen Y have right now done has been phenomenal in raising kids through lockdowns, working remotely when it's never been tested on a mass scale like this before. The Gen Ys will be able to look back really proudly, I think, and probably even should do that right now. Give yourself a pat on the back saying, yep, I've done the work from home thing while parenting, or even for single Gen Ys, they've raised their career profile during a period of great uncertainty, and hopefully it's a good opportunity for Gen Ys to really progress their career, whether it's through extra study, through taking on more responsibility in work, because certainly there's an appetite for greater responsibility to be passed to Gen Ys. And I think we're going to find that this generation can stack up and can handle that. We've got our first Gen Xer Prime Minister in Australia. We've had that now. And so certainly looking to the next decade ahead, I wonder if we'll see the first Gen Y Prime Minister in Australia in the decade ahead.
Yeah. Oh, such a good topic. Always love chatting generations. Always love having you on the podcast. Thank you so much for the chat today, Geoff. It's been great having you back.
Yeah, thanks, Ash.
And if people would like to stay up to date with our latest insights at McCrindle, you can always subscribe to the podcast, follow us on social media, or just head to McCrindle.com. And once again, as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.